Hey guys, this is Musings of Mavri. I'm Mavri, and today we're going to be watching Goblin Slayer Episode 5. So, last time where we left off, our group of adventurers just managed to clear out a goblin lair. They killed an ogre, and by all means, it seems that they might have completed their mission. So, you know, the other three companions that came afterwards, the High Elf Archer, the Dwarven Mage, I guess, and the lizard man necromancer is what I believe I said last time. They should be going back to their respective armies, or maybe they'll ask Goblin Slayer to come with them. We don't know. But like I said, I think maybe the catalyst of getting Goblin Slayer to leave his sort of territory and go into the world at large is probably going to be that within the demon king's army, there's going to be some goblin generals there, and so that will entice Goblin Slayer to go out and slay them. Right, and we're currently on episode 5, so we're about halfway there to what the series is at right now, which is on episode 8. So, without further ado, let's get started. In 3, 2, 1, go. That guy? Oh. Okay, it's this childhood friend. I called her, you know, looking like a bunny before, but I believe she's actually called Cowgirl. I still think she looks more like a rabbit, though. And she has red eyes, right? Oh no, they should be recurring characters. I mean, all the key visuals use them, so... Right, and here's the opening, so I'll see you guys in a sec. And we're back. Adventures and daily life. Oh, I noticed that they didn't begin with the, you know, mythology this time. Whoa. That's a big rat. Is this the group that got back from the goblin hunting? Holy smite. So she's also, so is she a paladin? Ooh. Giant cockroach. Ew. Yeah, I would run too. So are these two also going to be recurring characters? Wait, these guys are still around? Cheese? Oh, no. Dragon that likes cheese. Oh, I mean, sorry, he's not a dragon. He's a lizard man slash dinosaur slash dragon. Not interested. Whoa, what? Okay. Where's Priestess? Like I said, I like, how this wizard looks, but the way she speaks, oh. Is there like a magical space in here? What the hell? That has to be like an innuendo. So he can't just find that magician or wizard. Ah, here's Priestess. Oh, nice. Okay, so it's not like you just do enough deeds or complete enough quests and then you rank up. Ah, she doesn't care. She only knew them for a few hours. Oh, and they're silver. They don't look silver, though. I would have thought silver ranked would be more rare. I mean, as far as I know, based on the light novels, silver ranked are the highest that you can get without being under the direct cooperation with the country. No money. Oh, this is interesting. Okay, so precious stones are first and then bronze. Oh, looks like someone's gonna fail. Is he going to? He's going to be trouble, isn't he? But still, it looks like these guild girls hold a lot of authority. Ooh. This reminds me of Ragnarok, actually. The MMO Ragnarok. I mean, yeah, Ragnarok Online, RO. Well, that was easy. Oh, we can do that? Ew. 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 This actually grosses me out more than all the goblin scenes. Lawful good to chaotic evil. They even make that reference. You know, the 9-part grid of morality. The Sword Maiden. Demon Lord. Okay, it's Lord. Oh, he got it back. Congratulations. Okay. The Supreme God? The Sword Maiden? So now we get the dice rolling reference. And that's it. Is there anything at the end? There might be. I'm going to jump ahead just a while. And if there's anything else, I'll show you guys. Alright, so that was the end of the episode. Nothing special happened after the ending. So I guess we'll just jump right into the thoughts and review. So this was a bit more of a filler episode. It's probably meant for world building, actually, so you can get a little bit more of the sense on what kind of systems, what kind of, you know, laws, rules exist within this world. We had a little side character quest, I guess, or side story with the newbie swordsman and his companion, probably a pseudo-paladin or cleric or something like that. Where they tried to get back their sword. And I thought it was funny that, you know, Goblin Slayer giving him some advice on what kind of weapons to use. So even though Goblin Slayer specializes in killing goblins, it looks like he still has at least a certain degree of, you know, normal skills, basically. So this also kind of debunks my own theory on how he got to silver rank. Right, because originally what I thought was maybe they can simply earn ranks by completing quests, and so being the Goblin Slayer, maybe he completed some quests that had very high level goblins with them, like the goblin generals or lords that he mentioned before, and he might have done so using his wits, his intelligence, rather than through brute force. But as we can see here, in order to advance for ranks, you still need to go through a test with the guild members and also have an observer. Although, looking at this setting, it seems that you don't it's not necessarily a test where you have to prove your prowess. Maybe it's more like an aptitude test or something? I don't know, but definitely doesn't seem like a field test. Or there might be a field test component and we just don't see it here since this guy was rejected already just based on his morals. And speaking of morals, I like that they put the alignment system in there, not the morality system, it's called the alignment system, which is also a feature of Dungeons & Dragons, and you know, where you're basically divided into a grid of 9 different sort of like morality and basically what you believe in. So it goes from, you know, from lawful to neutral to chaotic, and then it goes from good to neutral to evil, right? So, you know, 3 times 3 equals 9. You can just look it up if you don't know about it. It's pretty widely known. So they made a reference to that, again reinforcing the idea that this is entirely based on a Dungeons and Dragons setting. So I guess there's probably going a lot more that you can catch if you're you have experience with Dungeons and Dragons, but unfortunately I don't. So I can only know tidbits of it, which were passed on to other RPGs and fantasy works. So what else is there that happened in this episode? So his other three companions are also still here, even though they technically should have completed their mission already. So for some reason or another, they're still staying here. One is like, "Oh, I want cheese," and the high elf girl, I guess she has sort of a crush on Goblin Slayer now, whenever that happened. I'm wondering if, you know, this is how it was, or whether because of the anime format, it just skipped a lot of context between, you know, when they first met until this scene. Otherwise, I think it kind of progressed a little bit too quickly. You know, so like, since when did she have a crush on Goblin Slayer, right? And speaking of which, man, the Goblin Slayer has a lot of babes around him, right? And they all pretty much to a certain degree like have a crush on him, I guess. So there's this cowgirl, right? His childhood friend, who's obviously still very much enjoys Goblin Slayer's company. And then there's also Priestess, who, by the way, Priestess, even though I mentioned that she reminded me a lot of Index from, you know, the other anime Index, she has a much more lovable personality, I have to say. At least, you know, even though she still, you know, has a very high sense of morals, I guess, you know, being somebody from the temple or whatnot, but at least I feel that she's more willing to listen and, you know, takes Goblin Slayer for who he is, basically. But anyways, it's pretty obvious that she also has sort of like a crush on Goblin Slayer. And then there's the high elf girl, who, like I said, I don't know when, but apparently she does. And then finally, there's the guild girl. Yeah. And well, apparently, girls in this universe like stoic people. So, hey. And I guess that's about it for this episode. Oh, and one final note is well, actually, two final notes. One is, I wonder if that, you know, that rogue who, or sorry, I think it was a scout. That scout is going to be any trouble in the future because, you know, it certainly seems like one of those situations where they will come at the most inopportune time to inconvenience our main characters. He just seems like that type of character, right? So, possible, possible. And then the other thing is the big cliffhanger at, well, maybe not big cliffhanger, but, you know, the big thing mentioned at the end of the episode where Goblin Slayer got another request to slay goblins. This time it was a special request. And apparently, judging by how it was cut, the Sword Maiden requested him. This is the same Sword Maiden who worships the God of Justice, I guess. I mean, although it says that she serves the Supreme God, I'm assuming that her main alignment, this is what my favorite right now, is that there's a Supreme God above all of them, right? And then there's a lower, a next tier of gods. And maybe the God of Justice is one of those, you know, second tier gods, just below the Supreme God. Because if you look at the mark, and if you look at, you know, the ending temple where we saw the Sword Maiden, it seems that it has, you know, that scale thingy, so probably a reference to justice. So yeah, that's what I'm thinking right now. And the Sword Maiden follows the God of Justice, and but they're all ruled by the Supreme God. So, anyways, I want to see the next episode. So I'll see you guys in just a second, or I mean whenever you see the next episode. So anyways, stay tuned. And bye-bye.